Hello and welcome again to my watercolour channel. Today I'm going to take you through lots of do's and don'ts for painting a cat's eye in watercolour. I'll show you all the tips and tricks which I use along the way, revealing many of my techniques. Now if you do fancy trying this painting all the way from the start through to the very end and all in real time video, it will soon be available on my online school. You'll find the link in the description down below. So my first don't of today is don't use cheap papers. Because you find if you use a cheap paper, it could bend, it could cockle, the water will just soak straight through to the paper because it's not been specially prepared as with watercolour paper is. Do use a watercolour paper that's specially made for the use with watercolours, not just some general cartridge paper or anything quite basic. So I'd recommend that you look for a particular paper that's specially made for using with watercolour paints. And you generally find as well that the more money that you pay for paper, the better the quality of that watercolour surface. Another tip as well is to use good quality brushes. The ones that you buy from the discount shops are really good for a variety of different techniques, but if you want to do the really fine tuned paintings, really fine details, then you've got to look for something of a reasonable quality. Now I'd always recommend as well using good quality paints. So very often with the cheap paints you find the pigment within them is nowhere near as vibrant as the better quality colours. And you can always tell when you start using really good quality paints, how they feel, how they look. It can make a massive difference to the quality and the look of your painting. So always buy the best that you can afford. That's the best way that I find I look at it with all the materials that you use for all your watercolour creations. Now when you're using large washes of watercolour, don't use paper that's not stretched or not at least taped down. Because you find if it's not stretched or taped down, the paper will cockle, it will bend, it will warp, and you find it very difficult to work on when you're trying to work on them fine details especially. So I'd recommend that you buy paper that's already stretched for you, so such as a block pad. Or you can stretch your own paper as well. Now I've got one little video which I can give you a link in the top right hand corner above on how to stretch paper the way that I personally do it with my own stretcher boards. Don't rush the outline drawing, so don't try and put that outline drawing onto the paper really quickly. Because you want to try and make an accurate drawing, so do use a very detailed drawing method. You could use graphite backed paper, the trace down system, you could even use the grid system as well. So there's many ways where you can get really good quality and very accurate drawing onto that paper, ready to start the painting. Now when you've got that outline drawing onto the paper, ready and raring to go, don't go too dark. So don't press on with a pencil, because if you do, it could damage the watercolour surface. And also, if the line is too dark, then you find that when you paint over that dark line, you find it won't cover it, and that line will show through your main painting. Some people like that effect, but with me as a fine artist, what I like to do is to make sure that the pencil marks are very fine and very light. At least that way, when you do paint over those lines, they will very often virtually disappear. Don't start a painting unless you've tested the colours out first. Because if you do make mistakes, you'll find it's difficult to correct because you've already got that colour down onto the paper. So do plenty of testing on little strips, little scraps of watercolour paper, preferably of the same kind that you're using, okay, so the same type of paper. At least doing it this way around, you'll have a really good feel of the colours that you're going to be needing to be able to start that painting with. And there'll be fewer mistakes along the way. Now when you do start working on a painting, don't be impatient with it. So do take plenty of time when you're working on a painting. Because if you take plenty of time with it, you find that you'll enjoy it even more. And very often you find as well that you produce a better painting by taking your time. Don't make the paper too wet. Because if it's too wet, you will find, even with a block pad, it will actually flood the paper and it will start to cockle even more. But you'll also find that when you apply the paint on that paper, it will just simply float on the surface of the paper. So do think about working on small sections at a time. So if you're working on, for example, this cat's eye, then you've got to think about where can I work on first. So don't wet the whole sheet, just wet the area that you want to work on. At least that way you'll maintain the wetness of the paper, allowing the water to soak in that little bit more before you start applying the paint. Now don't use a paint too thick when you start on a painting. If it's too creamy, too thick and too dark, you find that you won't be able to achieve that lovely kind of subtle layering which we need within, say for example, a cat's eye. And the same goes to the fur as well. So do work in very light washes of colour. So you're going to start off with a very pale version of the colour that you want first, which will give you the overall effect which you need within the eye. So don't just work with one layer. Do work with multiple layers when you're working with a painting such as this, or any paintings really of wildlife. because every layer that you add starts off very light to begin with, gradually getting darker as you apply those layers, but just make sure that every layer is nice and dry before you put another one over the top. And in turn, this will give you a nice deep feel to the depth of the eye and also with the fur. And you find the other benefit as well is that the lighter the colour is to begin with, if you're making a little mistakes along the way, they're much easier to fix when you've got pale paint on the paper rather than trying to take off a very dark colour, which very often results in damaging the paper. So start off light and gradually get darker with every layer that you use. So don't paint on a wet layer. So if it's still a little bit damp, don't paint on it. Allow it to dry first. Yes, you can paint on damp layers, I know, but that's for different effects if you want like a blurry effect. So do vary those details from those light tones first. So think about four different consistencies, okay? So we're working with watery, milky, creamy, and thick. So that gives you four different paint consistencies to work with. So starting with the lightest colour first, allowing it to dry in between layers, and every layer again go a little bit darker, a little bit more thicker on that paint mix, adding a little bit more pigment and less water to that mixture that you've made up. When you're working in fine details, you've got to make sure that every single layer is dry first before you go on for another one. So do allow the paper to dry or give it a blast from a distance with a hairdryer before you go back in with the next layer of paint. Now don't be too flat with your washes of colour. So when you're working on these basic foundation washes behind the scenes, so to speak, so behind the fur, think about the shapes that you can see within that reference photograph. So pinch into that photograph if you've got it on a computer screen or a tablet or something like that, and then you can see the kind of shapes and colours behind the scenes, behind that fur. So do use tonal variations of your foundation wash, your initial wash. At least that way, if you're working with different tonal variations, you're already kind of creating the overall shape underneath that fur again, aren't we? And that's what you've got to think about, as well as if you're painting in the middle of the eye. So remember that when you're working with the first washes of colour, think about the overall shape and think about adding slightly darker tones here and there on that damp, not soaking wet paper, remember, and then take it from there. Now when you're painting the fur itself, don't paint straight onto the white of the paper for painting fur. Because if you paint straight onto that white of the paper, it could be too stark between every single layer, every single fine hair that you put on there. So you do need that foundation wash we've just been talking about first. Okay, so foundation wash down, then allow it to dry or give it a quick dry, then start working on the fur. So do make sure that you've got a foundation wash on the paper first of all, before you start working on those details. Now painting fur, don't start off with too darker lines or too thick a mix of paint. Because you find if you do it this way around, like we said about the eye, so you won't be able to get that natural layering technique which you'll need to achieve for more kind of full and realistic kind of, well, deep fur really. So do make sure that you start off with the lightest colour first, then gradually get darker with every single layer of detail that you apply to that paper, allowing, again, every single layer to dry in between. Unless, of course, you're after a blurred effect. Don't just stick with one single colour or probably two colours for fur, because you want to look really deep into that photograph again. Remember I said about pinching into that detail on that photograph, so make sure they've got a very large photo for that. So once you can see all them details in there, you can then scan those colours. You can look at the colours one by one and say, hang on, that's got some blue in there, that's got some brown in there. So do look deep into that photograph and do make sure that you're going to paint all the details that you put on there, whatever layer of paint you put on, be it watery, milky, creamy or thick in consistency, that you're going to vary those colours throughout, okay? Even if it's just kind of slight variations of colour, it can all make a difference in the end. Now another don't is don't paint your lines too parallel with one another. So if you're using a specially made rake brush, or in my case, a homemade replicator brush, as I call it. I've got a little video on that as well, so I'll put a little card in the top right-hand corner of the screen for you now. Got it? Brilliant. But you do find that with these special brushes is that the lines can be too parallel, as I say, so they are far too in line with one another. So do vary those brush directions. So I tend to overlap the lines every now and then in elongated crosses, which even though they're still going in the sort of same direction, they are slightly overlapping, which gives a less combed look to the fur and a bit more natural as well. And also do compare your paint test to the reference photograph. So pinch into that photograph again and then offer that little test piece of paper up to the photograph to see if that's the right colour. Especially when it dries, you've got to remember that watercolour very often dries that a little bit lighter. Now another don't is don't place your hands directly on that paper. Because if you do so, you find you leave marks on the paper, because we've all got kind of natural oils, haven't we, within our skin. And that will act like a wax resist on the paper. So do protect that paper. And I use, for example, just a folded piece of printer paper, that's all I use. But it's a good way of just protecting that paper surface and gives you a nice clean paper to work on. If you do want to use white paint for the highlights, then I suggest you just take your time with this and don't add too much in one go. Because if you do, you find it will start to look, well, quite old. You know, your animal which you're painting will have, well, like grey hairs. So just be careful of that. So in contrast to that, do make sure that you take your time with this and just do a small area at a time. You know, if you're not sure if you're going to add any more paint on there, walk away, go make a cup of coffee, come back with fresh eyes, and then you can decide at that point, not on the spot, because you could end up very easily adding too much white paint. Now one of the other problems that people don't do correctly when working with white paint, be it watercolour white or white gouache, is having it too watery. Because you find that if it's watery, it can very often fade quite dull. It's handy for certain situations within a painting, especially if you're working on, for example, white fur of a dog in a shaded area, that's really useful for that. But generally, you might want to use that white paint quite creamy, especially if you want to add, for example, a highlight in this cat's eye, and trying to make that highlight really stand out. And it's also very good for kind of just finalising the painting to kind of add those extra highlights around, for example, his eye and the eyelids and even parts of the fur. And that will give you the overall effect from both the lights, the midtones and the dark contrasts for the overall painting. Now, one common mistake I see with my members is painting the pupil too big to begin with, because that doesn't give you any kind of wiggle room when you're working with a painting. So do paint it smaller, just that little bit smaller to begin with, and also look at that angle as well. So don't forget to look at the angle of the pupil in question, because in this case, as you can see on this cat's eye, it's not level, is it? It's not 12 o'clock, 6 o'clock direction. It's more between 1 o'clock and 7 o'clock direction as you look at the clock face. So bear these little things in mind when you're working on anything like this. Think about the direction which all the elements of a painting are facing before you make a start. See this full-time video tutorial on how to paint a cat's eye in detail, and over 80 other video tutorials as well available on my website. So come and join me on there. Why not try out the free membership first, just to see if it's the right thing for you, and learn my techniques and my methods of painting wildlife in watercolour. Now I do hope you really enjoyed watching my video. Now remember to click on that subscribe button and also the bell icon down below. And leave me a comment if there's any other wildlife you'd like to see me paint in watercolour here on YouTube. Let's head on to the next video on my right on how to paint a cat itself.